Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to my backyard. Here in Sugarland in the Orchard Lake subdivision, we've been living here since 2007. And so over those 13 years, we've been working to turn this property, this backyard, into a wildscape. And so that's why we lovingly like to call it the Hurley Early Birds Wildscape. And we're giving you a broad view here, a panoramic view of what we're going to be looking at today. And then later on during the tour, I'm going to be showing you what we have. We have about a quarter of an acre of garden here along Oyster Creek. And our philosophy is to be totally organic. We use compost. We avoid the use of inorganic insecticides. And so we've had a lot of fun working on this property. And so I do hope that you enjoy today's tour. And so you'll see a lot of ants and bugs and insects out here because we're totally organic. But the good news is that leads to butterflies and then birds and all kinds of mammals out here. But today I'm going to give you some tips and tricks and talk to you about the plants and show you the plants that have worked well for us as far as creating a wildscape, successful plants that actually produce results. And so let's start on the tour. All right, well, I'm going to start our tour here in the focal point of the garden, which is our African water feature that we bought in South Africa. I guess it's about 20 years old. And we just love the sound that it adds to the garden. I mean, it takes 10 degrees off how this garden feels in the summertime. It's very shallow up at the top, so the birds do use it as a bird bath up on the top. And then also the bees will use the rim to get water from this fountain also. So it's been very successful for us. And the first plant I'm going to talk about is the milkweed. We all have heard how vital the milkweed is for the preservation of the monarchs. As a matter of fact, the monarchs can only use milkweed to lay their eggs on. So it's important that we all try to grow as much milkweed as possible. Here in our area, we can grow all different kinds of milkweed, but usually the one that's found in the nursery trade the most is this one. This is the non-native, the tropical milkweed. It's so easy to grow here. It's easy to find in the nursery trade, but there's two problems with the non-native milkweed. Number one, the leaves become carriers of a parasite called OE. I don't even know what the long name is, but everybody just calls it OE. It's a parasite that's found on the leaves. And what happens is a butterfly comes along, lays her eggs here on the leaves. The caterpillars hatch and then begin to eat the infested leaves. And of course, it becomes infested also. So when it emerges from the chrysalis, it's deformed and can't survive. So that's not good at all. So the way to get around that is in September, before the monarchs go south for their migration down to Mexico, you want to cut this off. Early September is when I do it, and I just cut it back to 3 inches, however far I can stand it. And then you keep it cut back like that over the winter time. And then in March, then you let it grow. In early spring, let it grow. And then when the butterflies come north for their northward migration, then there's fresh leaves here. And they can lay their eggs here on the fresh leaves, and then there's no problem with the OE. And another problem that it has is because this grows 365 days a year, it never dies back, and so it has an adverse effect on the migration pattern of the monarchs. They kind of have a tendency to want to hang around and lay eggs, so that's not good, because if we get a freeze, then they're all going to be wiped out. So again, if you cut it back in September, then you don't have any problem with the adverse effect of the migration pattern. And another type of milkweed that we can grow here is your native milkweed, and it's by far the better type of milkweed to grow for the monarchs. It's getting easier to find it in the nursery trade. You still kind of have to hunt it down, but it's available, but it's so worth the work to try to find it. This is the aquatic milkweed here, and look at the beautiful blooms on it. It just pops here. It's got, it has the great texture, and it's just full of leaves and healthy, and it just loves it here. And that's primarily because of this bird bath that we have here, which has a dripper 24/7. Look at that, 24/7, 365. And the birds just love this bird bath. It, of course, it drips over, and this stays wet here, and that's why the aquatic milkweed really does love it. But it was very easy to put this together. It's just connected to a 1/4 inch tubing, lots of valves, and then it's buried underneath here and goes all the way to the faucet on the side yard. But we have had so much luck here with this bird bath. We just get all kinds of birds coming through here. We get more birds on the bird bath and the other water features than we do on any of the plants and any of the bird feeders. So I suggest it, if you could possibly put this together. It really has worked out very, very well for us. Oh, and another type of native milkweed is a swamp milkweed, which we have back over there. It's not really very showy right now, but it's a native, and the monarchs really do like that also. All right, and now I'm just going to talk about a couple of plants in this little corner over here. First of all, this is the American Beautyberry here. It's a perennial, gets about this big, and it gets berries, purple berries usually about this time, but for some reason these are all still green. And of course the birds will eat these berries during their fall migration. And I found out in order to keep it, oh look, there's a skipper. In order to keep this more compact, cut it back about halfway in the winter time, and then it'll be a little bit more bushy than this is. I did not really plant this. It must have come from a seed, from a bird. And moving on, over here we have the Texas red salvia, which is fantastic for hummingbirds. And it's so easy to grow. It's an annual, it reseeds readily. It'll just grow 365 days a year if you'll let it. But the hummingbirds absolutely adore this, so I would highly recommend that. And now the best thing that we have in this whole garden is the mulberry tree. We have one big mulberry and then one dwarf mulberry here, all planted in this one little corner. And this is the native mulberry. It's the Morris rubra, and you can get it at Caldwell's. But it's fantastic. It gets these great berries in the spring, just in time for spring migration. I mean, we get the orioles, the tanagers, the grosbeaks, and sometimes the scissortail flycatcher will be sitting up at the top to see what it can get. And it's been, these have been fantastic for us. In fact, we have 7 mulberries on this property, because we'll never be without a mulberry again. We had 2 big, huge, beautiful specimens over here, but they all both died within 6 months of each other. So we're so disappointed in that. It was just heartbreaking. But so now we have 7 all scattered around. We have to start all over practically. But we're looking forward to this coming spring when we expect this thing to get some nice fruit and we'll be able to see it birdwatch from the patio. Okay, and now we're going to go down the other side of the garden here. I want to talk about a few plants here. This is the Texas mountain laurel, which is a beautiful evergreen tree with sort of like glossy oval leaves. And this is the one that in the spring gets the beautiful purple flowers that sort of smell like grape Kool-Aid. Really nice. And it is great for alkaline soils. And we do have alkaline soils here because I had the pH measured and it was 8.2, which is very alkaline for plants. But anyway, and so you can see we've got a little chlorosis problem going on here. And that is a problem with alkaline soils because the plants have a hard time of getting the iron out due to the pH. And this is the larval host plant for the Henry's elfin butterfly. And so it's very, very slow growing. It's been in the ground here for quite a few years. And also, now I want to talk about this little ground cover. I love my ground covers. This little one over here with the white flowers, look at how cute that is. Now this is called frog fruit. It's a beautiful ground cover. It is the larval host plant for the Fayon crescent, which I have seen around here. And oh, by the way, we've seen 17 species of butterflies in the yard that I've been able to identify, and including the Fayon crescent. And so it's a beautiful little ground cover. And I got this ground cover thanks to Lan Shin. She brought it to the plant swap at one of the Sugarland Garden Clubs and assured me that it was, because she's all into native plants, and assured me that it was a great ground cover, not too aggressive, easy to take care of, and she's absolutely right. It's just been so cute, so much fun, kind of fills in here and there. And so I've really liked it. It's worked out really, really well. It's got a little competition throughout this bed with the white vein fimbriata and the wild Carolina petunia, but it's still hanging in there, still doing great. And then moving on down the line, we have pentas here, which of course, as you know, is great nectar for the butterflies. Oh my goodness, and so easy to grow. Look at this. This is the red, which of course will also attract hummingbirds, I guess. And but it's great nectar for the butterflies. They really, really do love it. So easy to grow. It looks like for some reason the pink is much shorter than the red and the white. There's a little bit of white in the background there. And another thing that you can do is provide water for the butterflies, and that's what we do over here. This is called a puddler. Oh look, there's a little green anole, baby, green anole. Called a puddler. And it's just a little bird bath here, teeny tiny, small little bird bath, and with different sizes of rocks in it, and your water, of course. And so it's great for the butterflies because they can just land here and pick out the depth of water that they require to get their water. And so it's very easy to do that. You can make your own just by taking a saucer from a pot and saucer combo, like a big one, and then just adding some rocks to it and of course your water, and put it in the ground, and voila, there you go, you have your own puddler. Okay, and now we're coming at you from the other opposite angle, and here's a beautiful specimen of the hummingbird bush, otherwise known as the Hemilia patens. And look, that's a little skipper right there. And the hummingbirds do indeed love this plant. I've seen all kinds. I had my doubts for a while, but no, now they really are all over this. So this is a beautiful specimen. It is sort of tender in the winter time. If we get a real cold winter, it'll die back, and then you just cut it back, and it's slow to come back, but don't worry about that, it will definitely come back. And then here's another ground cover that I have. This is the Carolina wild petunia. It's a native, so I just kind of let it grow wherever it wants to. And but it's very aggressive. It's very aggressive. I've been seeing there, it's just spreading all over the place, and it's only been in the ground for a couple of years. Maybe I started off with one, two plants, probably a onesie. You know, I've learned my lesson. I don't do the onesies and twosies anymore for your design. It's just too small of a little clump of your flowers, so it's better to at least do 3 or 5 or even 7, depending on the size of your garden. But so it's really very, very pretty. It gets these beautiful little purple flowers here. And then moving on down the line, over here I with the yellow flowers, I have the partridge pea. Now this is a onesie that I got from the Master Naturalist program. I'm a Master Naturalist of the Coastal Prairie Chapter, and our project is the Seaborn Creek Nature Park, and we have a nursery there growing natives, and if you volunteer there, then every so often you get to take a plant home. So this is the one that I took home. It's an annual, and it's a legume, and so that helps to fix nitrogen in the soil. It's a cassia, so it's the native, it is the larval host plant of the orange sulfur and the gray hair streak, and I've seen both of those here in the garden. And it's also in the sensitive plant family. So the leaves close up at night and they open back up during the day, but it is a very good, it reseeds itself readily. So I don't know what it's going to be doing out here, but I love the way it looks. It adds a nice little lacy texture to the garden. So we'll see how that turns out. And then another plant here is this Mexican beauty berry. And of course, right now it's the perfect little size. It's this nice little shrub. It's very healthy looking, thick, but it can, this thing will grow into a huge tree. In fact, this thing was a gigantic tree that came all the way over the pathway, made a nice little canopy, but it was just, it hardly ever had any berries that I saw. There was never any birds on it. So, you know, that's our philosophy. If something's not pulling its weight, if it doesn't have butterflies or bees or birds on it or something, well then, you know, we're eventually going to yank it out and put in something that will provide some sort of something for the wildlife. But if it would just stay like this, then that would be perfect, but it's not. We haven't killed it, obviously, so we may have to go back in there and do something else to try to yank it out. All right, and now by the magic of film editing, I have jumped over this garden bed, and I want to show the different certifications that we've gotten for the yard. The National Wildlife Federation provides this one, Certified Wildlife Habitat. It's just a little application online you fill out, and you tell them what sort of food, water, cover, and places to raise the young you have. I think you have to have 50% native, I'm not sure. And send in your money, and then they will mail you, they'll approve you, and then mail you this back. We also have a certified butterfly garden, and this is for the Hurley Early Birds Wildscape, which of course is what we like to call our place here. And we also have a certified monarch garden, and the habitat from the Monarch Butterfly and Pollinator Ranch. Now look at this big, huge tree here. This is your Eastern Red Cedar. You can see it's gigantic. Oh my goodness, it must be 30 feet tall or something like that. And this has been another, oh, there it goes, a bee. This has been another success for us. For a variety of reasons. Number one is great cover for nesting birds. We have had so many cardinals nesting in here, especially this year. We've had, several broods successfully fledge, and they're all little babies flying around here too. And also it gets gray berries that the cedar waxwings like in the winter time. Now the cedar waxwing was named after this tree, and so because they love these berries. It's really not a cedar, it's really a part of the juniper family, but it is found all over the country. 37 states, as a matter of fact, it's native. And of course this tree was vital to the Native Americans. They made all kinds of tinctures and potions and teas to treat a variety of ailments. And the pioneers used every part of this also, primarily the trunks, nice and straight and tall. They used that for wood for fences, cabins, furniture, you name it. And plus, it's great for Christmas. Makes a nice little centerpiece. Just come in here and chop everything off. But you can see how big it is. It's just huge. It's blocking out so much of the sun. I mean, this plant, I'm not kidding, it was like this big and it's skinny when we first planted it. And look at it now. I mean, it's what, maybe 10 years or something? And look at the size of it. The trunk is like this. But, you know, it's been a great plant for us, especially now that so many birds are nesting here. To talk about this beautiful little color spot over here, This is an old wheelbarrow that my husband had, and he was getting ready to pitch it because it has holes in the bottom. So I said, hey, let's just put it in the garden and upcycle it and make it into a planter. So it's got all kinds of soil underneath here, good quality soil. And look at the color. This is Angelonia, otherwise known as the summer snapdragon for our area. And great, great color. And then I've got the rock rose here, and it's got a great color also. And then I like to add a little garden art, talk to the plants. And here's a little stand, a little sign here that I got on clearance at Hobby Lobby. Pardon my weeds, I'm feeding the beads. How about that? That's very appropriate. And look at our collection of old garden tools, which is from my family and my father and my grandfather and my grandmother also. She was a very serious gardener. And we have all some other old garden tools, you know, that they used. And we have quite a few Texas things over there. And this Texas right here with all the holes in it. Now that used to be a jalapeno popper griller that my husband had. And but don't buy it because it doesn't work. And so Greg said, hey, let's just chop all this stuff on the back and we can hang it up in the garden as garden art. And look at that, it worked really well. But don't buy it because it just burns the stuff on the bottom. And moving along down here, this is red fire spike. And this is a beautiful tropical looking plant. It's not native, but it adds a beautiful texture to the garden because it's glossy. And in the fall, it gets beautiful red spiky flowers, which the hummingbirds love. And so it's getting ready to bloom here. Looks like I've got a little chlorosis going on here. And but this is another good one, just as for an additional type of texture to your garden. And then this is the mealy blue sage, which butterflies and pollinators really, really do like. It's a perennial, so I do cut it back every year. And it likes full sun. And here it gets a lot of, like, the mid-morning to the early afternoon sun, and honestly, that's really not enough sun. So it has a tendency to flop over, so I like to pull it back with my bamboo stakes, and look at how good it looks. it has beautiful, beautiful blue spiky flowers on it, which just bloom almost year round until you cut it back. So it's a very, very beautiful plant. And I have three viburnum here. This is a case that I was talking about of, if it doesn't pull its weight and if it's a perennial, I yank it out and put in an evergreen flowering shrub. And this is one of them. These are three types of Walter's viburnum. And the first type is over here. This is the standard. This will get about 18 feet tall. And it's kind of short right now because I did have to chop it back this year, early in the winter time of this year, because it was getting kind of leggy. So I chopped it back and it's doing a whole lot better now. It's coming up from the bottom with a little bit bushier. And so this is going to get 18 feet tall. So once again, it's, you know, eventually it's going to block out a little bit more of the sun. So we may have to do something about that. And this is the dwarf version. It's not going to get much taller than this. This is the Walter's viburnum again. And in the spring, it will get white flowers that the pollinators love. And so it's beautiful. It's really just covered with white flowers. So I really do highly recommend it. But there's other viburnums that are really native to Texas. So I need to try to plant some of those. And this is the World viburnum over here. You can see it's very short, and the branches sort of come out in a whorl, W-H-O-R-L, World viburnum. And this makes a great hedge. Any of these types of small leaf viburnums will make a great hedge. Don't use ligustrum or Eleagnus. You can use these and you can definitely shape it and it works out really well. I don't know what's going on here. but anyway, these have been great. No maintenance at all whatsoever. So this has been really, really nice. No maintenance in this little section right here, but lots of maintenance everywhere else. And now we're on the other side yard over here, and I have found that I really do love the succulents. They're so easy to grow in the containers because this backyard faces west and it just gets a hot afternoon sun and it's just boiling out there. But succulents can handle that heat. So from now on, in containers, I'm just putting succulents in. You can just get them very inexpensively. I got this one on clearance at HEB for $1. So that's pretty good. Now, another habitat that we provide is for the bees. And here's an example of this is our little bee house right here. Did you know that there's 20,000 species of bees in the world, but 90% of those do not live in hives? Everybody always thinks of the hives, but no, 90% are solitary. So that means that they will live in holes in the ground or holes in stems of trees or shrubs. And this is a great approximation of holes in trees and shrubs. Now, here in Texas, we have several hundred species of solitary bees, and they don't make honey. So they have no territory really to protect. So they're non-aggressive at all. They're safe around children and pets, and they are super pollinators. In fact, studies show that they are 3 times more effective at pollinating flowers and fruits and vegetables than the honeybee. And that's because of the way they land in the flowers. They do more of a belly flop, so they get the pollen on their bellies. And then when they go to the next flower, they do a belly flop and they get the pollen all over that flower. Whereas the honeybees, they get the pollen on their legs. And so they're just a little bit more, they land more gingerly onto the flower, and so they're not as effective as your native bees. And so this is what you want to do with your bee house is to face it so that it gets morning sun, sort of southeast, and you want it to be under eaves so it's protected from the rain. All right, and now we're over here by this bed, and we like to call this a butterfly bed, but really it's turned into a hodgepodge of everything over the years. But first I want to talk about this new thing that I'm trying, and that's grasses. This is the knotroot bristle grass over here, which once again I got as a volunteer at Seaborn Creek, and it's one of the easiest grasses that you can possibly grow. That's why I started off with it. It's a native bunch grass, and it's very easy to identify because it has cute little foxtail fern type seed heads, and the birds are supposed to eat the seeds, so we'll see if they do. And then also, of course, I love coleus. It makes such a nice pop of color in the summer against all this green. Look at this red. There's 2 different types there, and they're both doing so well. You just have to remember to pinch off the seed, the flowers, when they form. But Caldwell's has a beautiful selection of coleus, by the way. Now, here's my favorite ground cover right over here. This is the white vein Dutchman's pipe here, white vein fimbriata, and it's just gorgeous. Look at the shape of the leaves, and it's just nice and thick. Has really cute little flowers, look at that. And it is the native, it is the larval host plant for the pipevine swallowtail. And when we have a good amount of swallowtails coming through here, they will just, the larva, will, caterpillars will just eat this all to pieces. And, but that's okay, in a couple of weeks, it'll come right back. And we'll get another wave of pipevine swallowtails coming through here, but it's very aggressive. Well, I would say it's not too aggressive. This has been in the ground for maybe 10 years, and I'm just finally, in the past couple of years, starting to see a few little plants of it here and there, obviously from volunteers from over here. And it just looks great over there. It's a beautiful little contrast with the shape of the leaves. You can see the white veins on it. It's kind of hard to find in the nursery trade, but if y'all want some, just come on over. I've got little spots of it here and there that you can take. This is the Turk's cap over here, and it's native to Mexico and Texas also. And of course, it gets these red flowers here, which look like a traditional Turkish hat, Turkish cap. Boop! And it's very aggressive. The hummingbirds love it. It's very, very aggressive, though. I mean, this has only been in the ground for a couple of years, and it's just going everywhere, and I have to keep cutting it back. It likes shade. It likes a little bit more shade than it gets here. It gets a lot of morning sun here. And I just have discovered what's the problem with these leaves here is that when it gets too much sun, the leaves are small and sort of crinkled and misshapen. And so that's obviously what's going on here. It likes a little bit more shade than it's getting here. And then also over here, I have two varieties of lantana, and I wanted to go over those. I have the native. I have two plants here with the native, and this is the non-native tropical lantana over here. And you can see on the native, first of all, there's no pink whatsoever in the flowers, and the leaves are very rough and sandpapery, and then they have the little zigzag edges like that. And the butterflies do like this. But I tell you what they really love is this non-native lantana. The butterflies are all on this just all the time. Now there's no pink in this one either, in these flowers. So, you know, the lack of pink is not anywhere near a definitive parameter for your lantana. But the butterflies love it. They absolutely do love it. And you can see what a gorgeous plant it is. It looks great. The butterflies love it. Honestly, I never really see anything on these two. So I don't know. I'm going to keep it. And this is my favorite zinnia down here. This is the profusion zinnia. Look at how great it's doing. It's just full of flowers and so easy to grow. And the leaves just always stay so healthy. Never really gets a fungus like some of these other things do. And it just looks so great. And I got this from Enchanted this year, and I think they do still have some. So easy to grow profusion. Okay, I'm back. Carrying on. This is the hummingbird feeder, one of several that we usually carry, that we usually have. There's a hummingbird right there on the Angelonia. And we make our own nectar. It is one part sugar to four parts water. It's very easy for you to do. Don't put any red food coloring in it. They don't need it. And this is the rain guard that my husband made. He's very handy. He made this. This is a very inexpensive upside down clear salad bowl. And he's got all kinds of little gizmos, hardware gizmos in here. And then up top is another small little bowl for the bee ant moat. And so this has worked out very, very well. We're getting some action now in second week of August. Now I want to talk about this beautiful tree here. This is one of our pride and joys here. This is the Mexican olive. It is a beauty. This is the same tree that Diane Schomburg was talking about in her compost Zoom meeting. And it's evergreen. Stays in bloom with the beautiful white flowers almost all year round. It is really a keeper. We bought this maybe about 7 years ago, I think, and look at the size of it. It's just really, really beautiful. There's no maintenance involved. It's evergreen. Now, when it rains, a few of these leaves will turn yellow and fall off, but that's really about it. I mean, we do get some of the flowers that fall to the ground. But it really is a wonderful one. And the hummingbirds love the flowers. So do the bees and the butterflies and all kinds of other pollinators. And it's really very beautiful, very tropical looking. Highly recommended. We got this from Buchanan's. Greg picked it out. It's a winner. And now, just a couple more plants over here on this side. This is the flame acanthus, which is great for hummingbirds. Blooms in the fall. And it rains. When it rains, it blooms better. And so we had all, what was it, like 8 inches of rain or something for the past couple of weeks. And so it's doing great. Hummingbirds love it. And now over here, this is another variety of Mexican bush sage. This is the type that the hummingbirds really do like. It blooms in the fall with the purple pistil stamen, spiky flower with the white flowers coming out. So it's white on purple. The hummingbirds prefer that, I have discovered in this garden. I got this from Pam Allen, and so thank you, Pam, for giving this bit to me, because it's really kind of hard to find the white on purple in the nursery trade. You can find all kinds of purple on purple, but not much white on purple. It is a perennial, so I do have to cut it back, but it's well worth it. It's just getting ready to bloom. Just in time for, there we go, right there, just in time for the fall migration of the hummingbirds. And now we're on the other side of the garden in another very, very colorful spot that I'm very excited about. And again, this is a little area for the butterflies that we planted. We have the profusion zinnias. Which again is my very, very favorite zinnia. It's just so easy to grow. I've tried the other zinnias and I just couldn't get anywhere with them. But this I have no trouble with whatsoever. You can get all kinds of colors. Look, here's even a red, a yellow, and then of course the orange over here. That my very, very favorite is the orange profusion zinnia. It's just spectacular. Another spectacular plant is this Rudbeckia here, Goldsturm. It was the 1999 perennial plant of the year. And so you look at the concentration of flowers here. It's just really, really magnificent. There's 5 plants here. We just bought them this spring from Buchanan's. It looks great. It's definitely a winner. And over here, we have some pentas, more pentas, which again is just an easy, easy plant to grow for nectar for your butterflies. It's a non-native though, but that's okay. The butterflies really, really do love it, and the bees do too. Behind it is a native passion flower, which is the larval host plant for the Gulf fritillary. So if you see, I think it's a red and black caterpillar on there, that is the Gulf fritillary caterpillar. So I'm just going to let this grow up the lattice work here. You may have noticed our terracotta warriors over here. How about that? Aren't those really cool? A nice little sculpture for our tranquility, love, harmony, and peace garden bed. The story of this is, do you remember the Forbidden Gardens Park in Katy? It was a 1/3 replica of the real terracotta warriors in Xi'an, China. Well, it was just huge. Well, unfortunately, they went out of business and they were selling everything in there. So my son John and I went there with our dolly and stood in line for hours and hours and hours, but finally we were able to get in and just had our pick of all the various different warriors that were in there. So we picked these two and put them here, and they've been great ever since. It's a nice reminder of when we lived in the Philippines, we were lucky enough to be able to go to China and we saw the real terracotta warriors, so in Xi'an. So it's a lovely reminder of that trip. Now we're gonna go down this little pathway here. My husband just built this nice little pathway here and it turned out really great. This is another grass that I'm trying. This is the little blue stem. And again, I got this by working at the Seaborn Creek Nature Park. It's a bunch grass and you can see this is about as tall as it's going to get. I haven't seen the seed heads yet, so I guess I'm assuming that they'll come up one of these days. But in the fall, the foliage is supposed to turn red. So that's why I'm interested in seeing how this turns out. In the back, I have another plant from the Seedborn nursery, and that is the ironweed, which truly, I see, is just starting to bloom over there. It's a beautiful magenta type of bloom. This truly lives up to its name because I just dug this out of the ground there and in the prairie demo garden, which we're allowed to do. And I just took it home, not much roots, and look at it, it's coming back really well. This is the crossvine. In the spring, it gets beautiful apricot type of tubular flowers, which the hummingbirds really do go for. It'll just be covered with these apricot flowers, which is a nice bright spot for all of this darkness over here. Here's one right here. Look, it's still blooming. Still blooming. Isn't that pretty? Look at that. And then moving along, this is the giant cigar cuffea plant right here. It's supposed to get this tall, but it's kind of stunted for some reason this year. I don't know why. And it's not blooming yet either. Normally it will be blooming by now, but I guess it's because I cut it back this year. And so it's taking a while for it to come back. But it's, when it's in bloom, it has these little horizontal flowers. It's tubular. That come out and it looks like a burning cigar. It really is pretty cool. All right, here we are on the other side of the fence, and this is Oyster Creek along here. We get a lot of fantastic birds flying up and down here and along the shoreline. We get kingfishers coming through here. We get herons, egrets. We just enjoy sitting out here and just seeing what kind of wildlife we can get every day. Now this is your wax myrtle. This is a standard, it's not the dwarf. And this is another hugely successful tree for us. We have several on the property. And they are evergreen and they get these berries. The female plants get the berries, which are just scarfed up by the yellow-rumped warblers. We have so many yellow-rumped warblers in the wintertime. Here, because these trees have been in the ground since the very beginning. So over the years, they've discovered this big, huge stand of all these berries. So we get so many, but it's only the female that get the berries. So when you buy this, be sure you buy it in the wintertime when you can tell if it's male or female, if they have berries or not. We bought these at the big sale at Houston Garden Centers in the wintertime, and they were all in berry. So we knew that, you know, when they have their 70% off sale, that's where we got these. And over here is our main bird feeder section over here. In addition to all of the native food and nectar that we provide for the birds, we also supplement with bird feeders, and you can see quite a few. And we have two types of baffle here that we discovered are required to keep the raccoons off and as many squirrels as possible. You want to sight your pole to be at least 6 feet away from any shrubbery so the squirrels cannot jump from there to get on top of your feeders. But there's three types of bird feeders that you can get. And the first one is the tube feeder. And you can see these are all tube feeders. We have quite a few. We have your basic ones over here. And then we have fancier ones like this one over here. This one has shelled peanuts in it. And if a squirrel tries to get on it, of course, you know, he weighs too much. So it forces this down. But the blue jays love this. And now another type is the tray feeder, which is this one over here. And we have whole peanuts in here. And the blue jays love this. And the other type is the hopper feeder. And the hopper feeder is this one right over here. Let me just run back in here real quick. This is the hopper feeder, and we have safflower in here. for the cardinals. Safflower is loved by cardinals. Squirrels do not like the safflower. So many other birds do not like the safflower, but the cardinals, the finches, and the Carolina chickadees love the, and tufted titmice. They love this safflower, so this has been a great way to go also. And so, like I was saying, I've discovered that it's best to not provide seed mixes to the birds. It really winds up being a waste. If you have a mix, you put it in your tube feeder, various birds come up and they will just pick out what they like, and then the rest of it they'll just throw it on the ground, and you wind up losing a large percentage of your seed. What I do now is I separate the different types of seed. I have three types of seed that I provide. This is a finch mix. They call it a mix, but it's primarily white millet. It's like 90% white millet with a little bit of the Niger thrown in and a teeny tiny tad of red millet, but it's primarily white millet. So this has worked out great. We get the buntings, we get the finches, we get those little mannequins on this. And then I also provide the black oil sunflower seed, which is eaten by a wide variety of birds. And then also I provide the safflower, which I put in the hopper feeder. All right, and this is the pièce de résistance, which has been the biggest success that we've had of anything in here. This is our little man-made pond that my husband and son made for me for Mother's Day 1 year. And it's just been so much fun. It's just a very shallow hole that they dug out, maybe 4 feet by 6 or 7 feet, and they lined it with a thick plastic liner, which you can still see. They did this, I don't know, maybe 10 years ago, and it's still going great. Then you just line the edge of the liner with these flat stones, put more stones inside of it so birds can have the various height that they prefer of depth of water. And we also have a dripper on it, as you can see. And this dripper, again, is a 1/4 inch tubing that goes all the way to the side faucet over there. We have a lot of valves over here so we can turn things and have it change the velocity of the water coming out. We also discovered that the birds love to have logs going across so they can hop on here, look at the depth of the water, and then decide where they if they want to get in or not. This has been so much fun. We've had so many different types of birds come out here. We've had wood ducks trying to swim around in there. I've had an owl in here, eastern screech owl. And the way we know is because of this wild game camera that we planted here. This is a Browning. It's not that much money. It's attached to this pole and it's aimed at the pond. It's motion activated, and it also operates at night. There's a camera card in it. It doesn't go all the, you know, automatically to the computer. I have to come out here, take the card out, go back inside and just flip through the thousands of photos that you get out of here. We have seen all kinds of mammals also. We've seen the bobcat, the coyote, armadillo, possum, raccoon, squirrel, feral cats, feral dogs, feral hogs also, rats, mice, you name it, they've all come to this. And it's just so much fun to see what comes to this pond. We get so much action, so many different types of birds come through here during migration. And this lovely plant here is the yellow bells, Tacoma stands. And it is just one of the stars of the garden. It's attention grabbing, and it's native to Texas. And this has been a big success for us also. We get the bees, the insects, hummingbirds love this. And it's very easy to grow, good for alkaline soils. This is the species version. And you can see, my goodness, it's 12 feet tall up here. It's been in the ground for a few years, and so it's reseeding now. So I've got seeds all over, little seedlings all over everywhere. And it's also the larval host plant for the dog-face butterfly, which I haven't seen around here. But this is a great one. It's kind of misshapen right now. We had a little issues with some dead branches, which we had to chop off, but it's great. Now, this is a hackberry tree here. There are all kinds of native trees along the creek here. Now, these trees were here already, most of them. This is a hackberry tree, which is, a lot of people think it's a trash tree, but it's really not, because it provides berries for so many different types of birds, and it's also the larval host plant for the common buckeye. And what we've done is we have an owl box up there, and it's been up there for quite a few years. We've never had any owls in there that we've been able to see, but hopefully one day we'll get some tenants in there. That would be really nice if we could. And here is a long view of our area on the other side of the creek. Very wild out here, so it brings in a lot of the birds, because this is Oyster Creek. We are upstream of Cullinan Park. Cullinan Park is not too far away as a crow flies. So that was one of the reasons why we bought this house, was because we thought, well, hey, maybe some of those birds that use Cullinan Park every year, and there's a lot of them, might just make their way over to our property. And sure enough, they have. It's worked out really, really well. Very excited about it. So I hope you have enjoyed the tour today, and I've really enjoyed having you here. It's still a work in progress. As you gardeners, as you well know, nothing is ever finished. We're still have quite a few non-natives here, but we're working on that. But I just wanted to point out this book to you. This is Bringing Nature Home by Doug Tallamy. This has been a big inspiration for me to continue to get out here and just improve the habitat for the creatures. And in this book, he mentions that there's 100 million acres of lawn, landscape, non-productive, traditional plantings. And just imagine if even just a small fraction of those millions of acres was converted over to native plants, habitat. What a great benefit that would be for nature. And he likes to call that homegrown national parks. And so that's what we're trying to do here, just to create our little 1/4 acre of a homegrown national park. And I'd like to invite any one of y'all to come out and sit out here on the patio for a little cup of coffee, and we can bird watch. So thanks for coming. Thank you.
Thank you.